factor, it is death. But those who set their mind in the spirit will receive peace, and eventually they will receive life. Friends of Jesus, the entire Christian life is embedded in Romans chapter 8. The power, the ministry of salvation, or the plan and the story of salvation, or the issues affecting humanity as far as salvation is concerned, they are all but one embedded in Romans chapter 8. Look at this. Romans chapter 8 verses 1, verses 30 and 33 talks about justification. And we did mention and say it, that justification, it is when God decides to make you clean, when God decides to make you better, when God decides to make you right, when God decides to make you look like you are not a sinner anymore. That can be found in Romans chapter 8 verses 1, 30 and 33. Number 2, in Romans chapter 8 verses 2 up to 17, Paul is arguing the walk with Jesus demands of you to put your eyes in the spirit. And therefore, this is sanctification. Walking with God, walking with Jesus, you don't gratify the power, the flesh, the gratification of the flesh. Rather, you should gratify the power of the spirit. And that is verse 2 to 17, which is about sanctification. In verses 18 to 39, Paul is introducing to us a great element that we are awaiting for, and that is an element of glorification, when Jesus will be coming to us so that we can move with him to where he is. And therefore, chapter 8 confirms the believer's union with Christ, the liberation in Christ, the indwelling power of the Holy Spirit, the regeneration, the mortification of sin, how sin eventually dies and it has no power, the adoption by God into sonship. It is Romans chapter 8 that will tell you we have been adopted by God into sonship. We have been adopted with God into his closeness. And therefore, we are no longer called by our name, but we are called the children of God. Romans 8 will also tell you about the inheritance factor in Christ. It will also tell you about the future glory which we are awaiting, the intercession of the Holy Spirit, the providence of God, the foreknowledge, the predestination, the effectual call, and the eternal security in Jesus' name. It's a powerful text. Romans chapter 8. All this in one, they will tell you how you need to read this book of Romans chapter 8. Friends of Jesus, Romans chapter 8 reminds us of the Holy Spirit's work in our lives as a Christian. No one can live in a Christian circle. No one can live in a Christian life in their own strength. The only person who ever did that, and he did that very well, it is Jesus Christ, because we are told that he took our bodies, he took the sinful body so that he can save us. No one on earth can live like a holy person with their own strength. It is only Jesus who did that. The only way, therefore, you and I can live in the Christian life, it is by the power of God's Spirit. It is by the power of the Spirit of God that is indwelling in us. So Paul is trying to convince the children of God that for you to walk with God, for you to become a real Christian, for you to be effectual in your Christian walk, you need something inside you. Chapter 7, which we saw in the afternoon, says that there is something in you. There is something in you that makes you not do something that you need to do. Paul is refuting that fact in chapter 8. And he's saying, whether that thing is there or not, there is another force that is better, that is bigger, and is called our helper, who is our Holy Spirit. So Paul, when he's introducing to us chapter 8, he only wants to tell you, forget about chapter 7. Chapter 7 tried to give you bad news. That when I try to do good, I don't do. When I try to become better, I don't become. Paul comes with a new concept altogether. That chapter 8, there is an introduction of a helper. The power of a helper. Oh yes, a child who wants to start walking. If it is not God's time, the baby will not walk. Young parents who are here, you will realize that any time you have a baby in the house and the baby has not started walking, you become disturbed. Saa zingine hata unajipata unaanza kumforce atembee. Because ukienda kwa majirani unapata the age mate kwa hiyo baby wako wanatembea tena wanapiga mbio roundi muenda. Lakini ukikuja kwa wako hasongi. So you start getting worried, you tell your wife, what is happening? Can we try? You start, mtoto anaanguka. Why? Because it's not God's timing. It's not God's timing. But when the timing of God reaches, you cannot stop that baby from walking. The timing of God. Similarly so, Paul is saying, there is something in you. You force yourself to walk better, you can't. You force yourself to be a good Christian, you can't. You force yourself to do good, you can't. You force yourself to be better, you can't. You find yourself, kama mtoto. You find yourself, umeanguka. You find yourself, umeanguka. Paul says there is good news. There is good news. There is a force you need in your body. And this force that you need, it is what we are discussing as the power of the helper. Can I hear an amen here? You know, in the context of the Bible, there are only two persons who are called the helpers. Person number one is a woman. Person number two is the Holy Spirit. Kwa Biblia yote, kuanzia Genesis mpaka Revelation, there are only two persons who are helpers. Na kama kuna mtu amesikia kitu yenye nimesema, angeshout amen kitambo sana. Especially our mama wenye wamekaa. Even us as a man, we have never been equated with the power of God. It is only a woman in Genesis, let us make a helper. It is the same word that God is saying, our Holy Spirit is also what? It is a helper. So men, don't joke with these ladies in the houses. Don't joke with them. They occupy a very strong position. And in fact, when you go to Revelation in the prophecy, it says they are also a church. These are powerful women. And women don't walk like you are weak people. Tembea ukikuja kwa kanisa like somebody who owns their own world. You are a powerful person. Wacha kutembea kama umenyeshewa na maji. Wacha kukaa kwa kanisa ni kama umeiba kanisa. Come like somebody who is so highly esteemed. The Bible refers to you as a helper, the same reference to the Holy Spirit. The Bible refers to you as a church, somebody who is very powerful. You're not just somebody. You're a powerful person. You're not just somebody. You're a powerful person. Now, for you to understand the power of the helper, I felt I should pause and get out a certain misconception that is mushrooming in our churches. The misconception I'm talking about is called Trinity. In Romans chapter 8, you will find Trinity in its fullness. Trinity, it is God in three persons. Trinity, it is God in what? Three persons. It is not three persons in one God. It is one God in three persons or three faces. How do you see that? Romans chapter 8 verses 1. Listen. The Bible says, there is no condemnation now to those who are in Christ Jesus. Person number one. Christ Jesus or the Son. In verse 2, listen. For the law of the Spirit, person number 2, Holy Spirit. Number 3, verses 8, the Bible says, the Bible says in verses 8, those who are in the flesh cannot please God. Person number 3. And therefore, Trinity, like people are talking about nowadays in SDA Church, and I want to pause here to correct this misconception. There is a certain group that has come in SDA Church nowadays. In it was Seventh-day Adventist Church. Seventh Adventist Church, they are opposing Seventh Adventist Church. One of their teachings is that the Trinity does not exist in the church. They are saying one member of the Trinity is powerful than the other. And they say this: God is more powerful, God the Father, than God the Son, and than God the Holy Spirit. They look at as one God, as three gods. They say all the three are different gods with different offices. It's not true. We only have one God. One God is manifested, is revealed in three persons. Are we together, friends? I've seen it in the university so much, especially our university where we have Adventist beliefs, Adventist congregation. Most of these young people, they have received a certain misconception, telling people that we do not know what Trinity is. Trinity is not there. Let me confirm to you the position of the Bible and the position of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. We believe in Trinity. Trinity, it is not three gods. Trinity, it is one God in three persons. Are we together, friends? Which are demonstrated in Romans chapter 8, verses 1. Now, let me demonstrate it now in a human language for you to understand better. My elder just come. Chairman, our elder for the camp meeting, is called Bob, right? I'm Asio Eugene. Ah, good. Yes. Now, let me use CRISPR. CRISPR. Are we together? Yes. Elder. Now, Elder is called CRISPR. Are we together? Yes. Elder is also married and he has a child called Christian. Yes, Christian. Are we together? Elder is also an elder in this church, or a chairman of the camp meeting. Are we together? So let's say he's a husband, he's a father, and he's also a chairman. According to you in your analysis, unacheka ukiniangalia. Muangalia hapo uniambie husband iko wapi? Na chairman iko wapi? Na Christmas iko wapi? Can you disintegrate? Unaweza toa mbili. So is it three in one or is one in three? Thank you, Elder. You can sit down. Most of the time, people don't understand the concept of Trinity. Trinity is not about three gods in one. No, it is one God manifested in what? Three persons. And let me tell you, both Father, the God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, it is in their nature. God in his nature, his nature is to become God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit simultaneously, together in one at the same time, perfectly complete in the triune fellowship of love. And therefore, there is a misconception. People say that Trinity is a pagan idea. Number two, Trinity is a mystery that you cannot understand. It could be true, but not true. Number three, that Trinity is a doctrine of unreasonable. In other words, it's a doctrine for people who don't think. Number four, Trinity is a doctrine that can be true because the word Trinity, it cannot be true because the word Trinity cannot be found in the Bible. Number five, Trinity denies the oneness of God. And lastly, these people, the proponents of disregarding Trinity, say God cannot be three persons and at the same time, he is the same God. Those are misconceptions. Listen to the fact. Fact number one, Trinity is a single and inseparable unity of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Fact number two, Trinity is the creator. Oh yes, during creation, God the Father was there, God the Son was there, God the Holy Spirit was there. All the three, one God in three persons was involved in creation. Fact number three, Trinity was there in redemption or salvation. God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit was there in person during salvation or is a savior. Number four fact, Trinity is not tangible. If you are looking for Trinity to touch it so that you can believe it, you will never find it. Fact number five, Trinity is not visible. If you are looking to see where Trinity is seated or where you can spot it, you will not find it. Trinity is not visible. Lastly, Trinity is a mystery, which sometimes even us with our mortal bodies, we cannot understand. But what you need to understand, the Holy Spirit is God in Trinity, or Trinity is God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Question come, who is the Holy Spirit? When Paul talks of Romans chapter 8 and says, if you walk in the Spirit, you receive eternal peace and you receive eternity. What does Paul mean? Who is the Holy Spirit? Not what is the Holy Spirit. Did you hear me? You cannot call God what. Who is the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit is God. The Holy Spirit is co-equal with God the Father and God the Son, and is of the same essence. He participated actively in the work of creation, salvation, and sanctification. The Holy Spirit is God. He is co-equal. He participated in the three phases of this world. Phase number one, when the world was being created. Phase number two, when the world was being saved. Phase number three, when the world is retained in the Godship or in the walk with Jesus, otherwise known as sanctification. And therefore, the Holy Spirit, He is now manifested actively in the work of sanctification. Let me wait, make it a bit deep, easier to understand. God the Father is revealed or manifested so much when the work of creation is being done. That then does not mean the Son and the Holy Spirit were not there. They were there. But the purposes of revealing, just like there is a committee for the camp meeting, but the chairman chooses to speak on behalf of the committee. That then does not qualify. The chairman is the one planning the camp. There is a committee, but the chairman speaks on behalf of the entire committee. So when you want to understand God the Father so much, He is revealed so deeply, manifested so much. During creation. Number two, God the Son is manifested or revealed so much and so deeply during salvation. That then does not mean God the Father or God the Holy Spirit was not there. He was there. But for the purposes of clarity, God the Father, God the Holy Spirit decides to manifest itself and become a son, somebody you can walk with so that you can understand the gospel. For 31 years thereafter, He goes to heaven. Number three, God the Holy Spirit is manifested so much when the work of sanctification is in our lives. That then does not mean God the Father, God the Son is not present. He is present, but for the purposes of helping us with our walk to walk to Jesus, God the Holy Spirit now manifests itself. When Paul talks about the Spirit in Romans chapter 8, I want you to understand, the Spirit is not a lesser God. The Spirit is not a helper it does not infer. As far as English is concerned, to mean that God the Father is so strong, so the second in command, who is God, the Holy Spirit is coming to help. No, He is not an helper according to the grammar of English. He is an helper because He is God Himself in us. Can I hear an amen? He is deeply engraved in us. And therefore, we do not have qualifications of the strength, as far as strength is concerned, that, oh, God the Father ni mkubwa, hata Biblia imesema, God the Holy Spirit is just a helper. No. He's not a helper for the sake of English helping. He's a helper because God has chosen Him to be a partner with us in our walk to walk daytime. walk with work every day with Jesus. That's where the issue of helping comes. Let's continue. John chapter 14, 16. The Bible says, and I will ask the Father, I will ask the Father, Father, and he will give you another helper. If you want to know, that helper is not a small helper. Which case is beginning the word helper? Case. Small case or upper case? It's an upper case, or which we used to call a small letter and capital letter. That in itself, unless your Bible has a problem with translation, but it must begin with an upper case to confirm to you it is not a helper for the sake of helping. Are we together? It's not helping for the sake of grammar. Vile unaweza sema unajua I'm a helper to elder. No. Sisi kibwanadamu tunaweza sema I'm a helper. But the helper that Paul is talking about or Jesus is talking about, it is God. The same way you write God with capital G is the same way you write helper with capital H. Can I hear an amen? Helper, I will send you, I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever. John 15, 26, the Bible says, but when the helper comes, observe the word helper. When the helper comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father, he will bear witness about me. It means it is me. But now the manifestation of the Holy Spirit takes charge. He is bearing the same witness with me. Listen to John chapter 16, verse 7. The Bible says, nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I don't go, the helper will not come to you. It is to your advantage. Just like it is to our advantage as SDA Church to see 666, to see 666 coming. It is to our advantage. It is not to our disadvantage. To see anza kutetemeka mkisikia vitu imetokea, you start giving misinformed prophecy. Yeah, tumeona vaccine ya corona inakuja. Ndiyo hiyo 666. Obama amekuja Nairobi na gari imeandikwa beast. Sasa imefika Nairobi. Unaanza kufanya maombi na kufast. It is to our advantage. Revelation says, if it cannot come, the end will not come. So when it comes, you should be happy. Because masumbuko ya hii dunia imekwisha na sasa tunaenda kumulaki Bwana wetu. Stop me confusing people with some simple prophecy za kutetemesha watu. Corona vaccine itaisha, yes. After 10 years, something else will come. 10 unaanza kusema ndio hiyo. It is to our advantage. So when Jesus says, it is to your advantage that the helper comes, oh yes, he says, without the helper, without God the Holy Spirit, you cannot have sanctification. That is what Jesus is saying in a nutshell. That without the Holy Spirit, sanctification, potea. Because God, the Son, alikuja na akafanya justification. But God, the Holy Spirit, is now here to show us sanctification. So if I don't go to heaven, count it a loss to you. That's what Jesus is telling the disciples. Romans chapter 8, verses 1. The Bible says, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Those who are in Christ Jesus, there is no condemnation. Why? Because when you are in Christ, Christ himself would have been condemned in your place. In fact, you would have been condemned were it not for the mercies of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, church. You would have been condemned. But now because you have come to Jesus and you have decided to pick him as your faithful portion, as your faithful friend, as your partner, Paul says, there is now, therefore, no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because you are in Christ not by force, but voluntarily. You have accepted that I need to walk with Christ. The action, therefore, is irrevocable, irreversible, declared by God to be true forever. It is a done deal. Nothing goes back. I've decided to follow Jesus. It is an irrevocable call. It is an irreversible call. And that's why when we are going to baptize some of our friends on Sabbath, it is a decision they have made. They will not go back again. It is a one-time decision. It is a done deal. When Jesus is being visited with a Pharisee called Nicodemus, in human terms, he's asking Jesus, how can I go back to the womb again? Nicodemus didn't know. By accepting Jesus once and you get baptized, it is a done deal. It's a done deal. After which, the power of the Holy Spirit descends upon you. And now you start walking with Jesus. When Jesus is getting baptized in Matthew chapter 3, you will realize there is a voice coming from heaven. God the Father is being manifested. Then there is another action of a dove coming from heaven, landing on his shoulders. God the Son, God the Holy Spirit being manifested. Then the one who is getting baptized, not baptism of sins, but baptism of salvation, is God the Son. The whole Trinity is being manifested in this action. So brothers and sisters, once you have accepted Jesus and he has saved you, Paul is saying there is no going back. There is now no eternal damnation. As a matter of fact, if you have not decided to follow Jesus and the heavens open now and the clouds come, Jesus comes down and he takes us to heaven, and you have not accepted Jesus as your personal Savior, Paul will reverse that verse 1 and he will say there is therefore condemnation to those who are not in Christ Jesus. But if you have accepted him and you say that, God, I need to walk with you. I need to walk with you, Jesus. I need you to empower me with the force, the helping force. Therefore, there is no condemnation in you. Brothers and sisters, because you are in Christ, you have escaped eternal death or condemnation and damnation. Because you are in Christ, you are now a new creation. The old is gone and the new has come. Because you are in Christ Jesus, you have escaped the wrath of God in Romans chapter 1. The wrath of God. You have escaped it. And Paul says, once you are in Christ Jesus, after escaping eternal damnation, he introduces another element in verse 2. He says in verse 2, for the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ. In other words, the Spirit does not enslave you. The Spirit makes you free. The Spirit creates in you liberty. The Spirit brings freedom in you. Not freedom to sin, but freedom free from the devil. Hallelujah, church. Free from the devil. Free from the shackles of the devil. Free from the chains. Free from the slavery force. Free from the influence of the devil. And now, you can walk with your chest up and high, telling the devil, I am a winner in Christ. I'm a victor in Christ. That is why when Paul is finishing, he says, what in verse, let's go to 8. That's why Paul says in 8, and he says, where is that verse where he says, yes. Yes, yes, yes. But one. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us. Do you love that verse?
Yes.
Paul says in that one, I've received the power of the Spirit, who is my helper. Paul now walks with the chest out, thumbing his chest up, going out to the villages, going to the estates, going to the business premises, going to his employment place. Paul goes up and says, listen to this. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He asks a question and he answers. He says, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all. How will he not also with him graciously give us all things? 33. Who shall bring any charge against God's things? Who shall bring any judgment about God's things? God has already appointed you. He has already selected you. He has already saved you. He has already put in you, either by imparting or by imputing. He has already put in you the power of the Holy Spirit. And Paul says, who then can be against me? Is it death? No. Is it diseases? No. Is it wealth? No. Paul says, all those things, I count them nothing for the sake of God's power. Listen to 37. 34. Who is to condemn Christ? Jesus? Who is to condemn? Question. Christ Jesus is the one who died after dying. More than that, who was raised in him and now is seated at the right hand of God. Doing what? Interceding for us. The ministry of intercession. We are a special people, friends of Jesus. Tell yourself I'm a special person. Oh yes. Imagine it's not your dad interceding for you. It's not your wife, it's not your mother. It is your God himself interceding for you. You're not a simple person, friends of Jesus. You are a great person. Imagine one boy, there's a story I read in the internet that a flight came from the US, and as it is going to Himalayas, by bad luck, it lost control. And when it lost control, people now were rushing all over to get the parachutes. Eh? And the vitu inaekwa kwa ndege yenye ukianguka kwa maji inaitwaje? For emergency. Inaitwa? Life jacket. Kuna watu wapo wanajifanya wamepanda ndege. Yeah, hiyo yenye mmesema. So, watu wakaanza kukimbilia, all over, people are rushing after those things. Then they found that a certain boy is snoring. The cowboy is just relaxed snoring. Then they asked the cowboy, hey man, what are you snoring and the plane has lost control? People are looking for rescue services. Kindly get yourself a jacket. The boy looked at that man and said, stop disturbing me. The man felt like the cowboy is arrogant. Death is coming and everybody is seeing death. The boy said, stop it. My father is the captain. And truth be told, it is his father who was flying the aeroplane. And his father, according to the faith of the boy, he knew his father cannot cause an accident when the son is there. The story says he controlled that plane until it landed safely. Friends of Jesus, it gives me a lot of faith that Paul says, what can disconnect me from my father? What is going to disconnect me from my father? Is it death? Is it wealth? Is it money? Is it materialism? No! Paul says nothing. The love that he has for me, he cannot let me get punished. He cannot let me be condemned. The love that he has for me, he came, he created me. Yes, I disappointed him and I sinned. After sinning, he came again, he invested himself and he saved me. Number two, yes, after that, I've been sinning severally. He sent again a helper who can help me in my daily walk. And therefore, Paul says courageously that what can disconnect me from the power of God? I know nothing. His love to me, it is so great. And therefore, verses 2, Paul says, for the law of the spirit of life has set you free. It has given you freedom from the freedom in Jesus Christ for the law of sin and death. Therefore, we have been liberated by the Holy Spirit from the influence of the governing authority of the law. The Holy Spirit is life because it gives life. Once it is life, it gives life. The Holy Spirit, it is God. It enlivens, it It empowers, it enables us as Christians in our Christian walk. The law of the Spirit has set you free from the law of sin and that of death. Justification and liberation, therefore, they are inseparable because they are bound together with the Spirit of God. God has set us free. That means, therefore, we have a break from our old ways. And now we can walk to the world and give them, listen here, world, listen here, friend, listen here, people. I have been saved. I am free. My old ways are gone. And now I'm in my new regalia. Can I hear an amen? Amen. I'm now a new creature. Mr. Perfect, listen. Yes, I used to sin with you, but I have changed. Mr. Perfect, listen, I used to be spiritually bankrupt, but now God has credited my accounts. My helper is powerful. This is the helper that the world needs so dearly to share with. This evening, friends of Jesus, because my time is up, allow me end with three things. Thing number one. It is in your Bible. Open your Romans chapter 8. How powerful is the helper? That is what I want to end with. How powerful is this helper? Romans chapter 8. Three things that you need to understand. How powerful is this helper according to Pauline writing in Romans chapter 8. Number one. Verses 11. If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead, listen carefully, look at your Bible. If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also. He will do what? He will do what, church? He will do what? In life. I'm talking about the power of a helper. Paul is arguing, if that helper is the one who gave Christ his life back, if that helper is the one who gave Lazarus life back, if that helper is the one who resurrected the tomb and opened the big stone and he told Jesus, come out, Paul is saying, that very helper is with you in Zimmerman. Amen. And is ready to give you life. Life. Thing number two. Let's go to Romans chapter 8, verses 16. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of who? Of God. There's another caption I saw in the internet. Of some two boys who are arguing. Then one cowboy said, you know what? My father is the greatest engineer in America. And he earns a lot of cash. There were three actually. Then the third one said, your father is an engineer, yes. My father, I am told, is the former president of America called Barack Obama. So the one of engineer became a little bit. Yes, he shrunk. Because, I thought my engineer is bigger. Yours is Barack Obama. Yes, the third boy said, I think, and I'm told by my parents, that my father is the owner of the world, is called God. Yours is an engineer, yes. Yours is Barack Obama, yes. Now I'm told with my parents that my father is the owner of the whole world and is called God. Don't you see the strong faith in this boy? That is the God that Paul is presenting to you in Romans chapter 8. That we have a privilege over the people of the world, that the world may possess all the material they need. The world may possess all the profession they need. The world may possess everything they need. But one thing you have beaten them down is that you're a child of God. Now walk to church like somebody who is a child of God. Dress like a child of God. Eat like a child of God. Speak like a child of God. Respond like a child of God. That is the outcry of Paul in Romans chapter 8. Thing number 3. Romans chapter 8 verses 26. The Bible says, likewise the Spirit help us in our weakness. Hey! Spirit does what? Help us in our weakness. Mm-hmm. It continued by saying, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself does what the church? Church, what does the Spirit do? Intercedes. Intercedes for us. In other words, the Spirit is so good. Paul says, listen, Gentiles, listen, Jews, you'd rather open your eyes and realize that the power of a helper is not just a helper, but is a helper that does 3 things. Thing number 1, we have said the Holy Spirit does what? Keep us what? Gives life. Thing number 2, the Holy Spirit does what? Makes us be called the children of God. Thing number 3, the Holy Spirit does what? It intercedes for us. How many together with me this evening are saying, God, that is the power of a helper that we need in our lives. Just rise up. Rise up. That is the Spirit power that we need. Paul argues, this Spirit is not just a force. It is a force that makes you be called a child. So when you're walking, in fact, when you go home, finish that text, Paul finishes and says, I don't care the sufferings that I go through on earth. I don't care. I don't care diseases. I don't care the sufferings. I don't care anything. Why? Because I have the power in me. And that power, it is the power that I respect because it's power beyond any other power. It is my prayer that you get those 3 things. The Holy Spirit gives you life. When Paul was dead physically, persecuting the church, killing people, abusing people all over, the Holy Spirit visited upon him and it gave him new life. When the Holy Spirit gives you life, you cannot behave the way you were behaving last year. You cannot behave the way you used to behave the other year. You will have to change by declaring that the Holy Spirit has given me life. Thing number 2, the Holy Spirit has placed you in an esteemed position by calling you the child of God. The child of God. And when you are a child of God, your work is just to say, Abba, Father. Abba, Father. Thirdly, the Holy Spirit is there to intercede for you. There's a musician called Gloria Muliro. I think if it's not Gloria Muliro, it is Size 8, who has sung a song that there are times I go on my knees to pray. And when I am praying, I forget even to say amen. I find myself asleep deeply up to morning. That is the weakness of a human being. There are times you cannot even pray. You feel you're tired. You feel you're so tired. Na usingizi imebekon. Mbako unajipato melala. May I confirm to you. When you felt that weak, the Holy Spirit was interceding for you in heaven. And that's why you woke up in the morning and you woke up in good health. May I give a call? Do we have anybody here who says, Jesus, I want to start a new life with you. I'm not baptized, but I want to make baptism my portion. This Sabbath, the church is going to baptize. And it's a special call for you, this camp meeting. We have spoken about the Bible, especially how Romans, we have started the journey of how sin as ravaged us. We have begun a very powerful journey on how we were created, how we were saved, and how to date. We are saying now, God is favorable out of love to give us the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit which is ready to walk with you. We are not confirming to you that after baptism, sin will not come to you. We are not telling you that after we baptize you, you are not going to be a sinner again. No. What we are confirming to you after getting baptized, you have, number one, an assurance for glorification with Jesus. That is a fact. Number two, you are now a new child of God. And after becoming a new child of God, God now has a place to put in you, or to impute in you, a new spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit to work with you. We don't need many people. And I see just one person who feels like he needs a new baptism, and this Sabbath we can put in baptism. Just raise your hand if you are there. To very powerful text that I like reading. Mark 16:16. Just read it from where you are standing at. It's a text that I'm dedicating to that person who seems that he needs a new baptism. What does it say? Mark 16:16. Yes. You found it? It says, he will be, listen how Mark begins that narrative. He who believes. He who does what? Believe. What we have been doing is to preach to you to believe. The entire of this week, all these lessons that we have been presenting here, including health, including stewardship, including literature, evangelism, and Bible study, we have been preaching to you so that you can believe. We are not forcing. We have been preaching that you believe. Number two, listen to those things. They are connected together. It is not he who is baptized, but the Bible begins by belief, connected with a conjunction. And that conjunction tells you that these are two equivalent practices. One, belief. Two, baptize. Then it finishes with a conclusion. After believing and you're baptized, what is happening? You will be saved. Do we have anybody who feels that he needs to be set to be baptized this life as we dip them into the water? Let us pray. Dear loving Father, our God in heaven, we want to thank you, we want to praise you, because you are a God that we cannot equate to any other God. We have listened to you, we have heard you. You are so gracious, you are so wonderful, you are so powerful. That King of the universe, were it not for your love, we would have perished. Were it not for your love, we would not be in existence. Were it not for your love, we would not be called your children. Thank you for that love, the love that has made the power of the Helper to be manifested in our lives. We have read in Romans chapter 8, the Lord, we have received a new Helper. A Helper in form of the Holy Spirit, which is ready to give us life, which is ready to make us your children, which is ready to intercede for us. Lord Jesus, that is the gospel. That is the good news. And now, as you are standing up, we are moving out of this tabernacle. As we shall be moving out, give us the strength to share this gospel with the world. As the world is waiting, condemned already, there is somebody who is hopeless somewhere. Jesus, may this message find a penetration in his heart. May this message become a seed in his heart. May this message continue to hover in him and continue to linger in him so that, Lord, he can give his life to you. I know there is somebody who wants to be baptized, but in one way or the other, he has not made a decision or she has not made a decision. Father, I know you are too much gracious. Just you are so gracious with the people of the old time. And Lord, when your children spoke to them through your prophets, indeed, they came to you and you forgave them. If there is somebody in this congregation, Lord, or any other person following us through media, who has decided that this Sabbath he need baptism, accept them into your fold. Give them another opportunity tomorrow, Lord. But in case tonight you may decide to come here and take us to heaven, may that person find an opportunity to ride in your wings. Forgive us our sins. Empower us with the Holy Spirit. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you and good night.